Please bow your head for a prayer. Dear Lord, we come to you today to worship you and help us to get our message across, the message that you want us to know. Bless us all, as all of us young adults, as we take over the service today. In your son's name I pray, amen.
Please be seated. I would like to say welcome to all of you. Thank you, Pastor Taylor, for giving us the opportunity to do this. The young people are really coming forth now. We're trying to get them more involved with the church, and we thank you for the family support. And what we do today, we hope it all points towards God.
You do, Heavenly Father, and all you will do. And Heavenly Father, thank you for your mercies. And you still give us time to make a U-turn and come back to you before the probation door is closed. And Heavenly Father, I just want to ask that now. You just bless us and fill us with your Holy Spirit. In Jesus' name, amen. Now it's time for our offering, and our offering this morning is for our church budget. And I want to read you guys a letter from Thunderbird Academy, I believe. And here it says, "Dear brothers and sisters in Christ, you can make an internal difference in the lives of our young people. Thunderbird Adventist Academy is leading a missionary trip to Livingstone, Zambia in Africa. Our teenagers are eager to go do 4 projects in this one trip. Number one, medical missionary work. They will be traveling from one village in the bush country to another with at least 4 doctors and 2 nurses providing much needed care. Number two is to building an evangelistic center in Livingstone. And number three, providing a VBS, Vacation Bible School program. And number four is to preach an evangelistic series. Our Thunderbird Adventist Academy missionaries are going to give them of themselves so that these dear people can hear the message of Jesus Christ. Please support them. On December the 15th, your local church will collect an offering to sponsor these young people. It costs $3,000 per student to go. They are working hard to raise the money, but they need our help. They need your help. For every $1,500 raised, a student missionary will be able to go. And when they return from their trip, we will send them to speak to each church that participated. Thank you in advance for your support, Thunderbird Adventist Academy." And let our ushers stand for prayer. Father, we thank you for your blessings. And now as we return partial of it, may you bless it. Heavenly Father, bless the hands that can give and cannot give, that they may be able to give next time. Just bless our little offering today. In Jesus' name, amen.
We're now going to have a song by the young adults. Silent Night, Holy Light.
Thank you. Happy Sabbath, everyone. The scripture this morning, let's go to Romans chapter 14, verse 4. Who are you to judge someone else's servant? To his own master he stands or falls, and he will stand, for the Lord is able to make him stand. Thank you.
Our second scripture for today is found in Psalms 51 and verse 10, one of my favorite texts. And here's what it says: Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me. Let me read it once again. Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me. Psalms 51, 10.
The name of my song today is Revelation Song. And I'm so happy that I get a chance to come up here and sing a song to God to glorify Him. And I thank you so much, Mr. Albert, that is going to play with me. And I'm so nervous right now, but I pray to God that I'll be fine. So if you know the song, you can sing along with me and enjoy it.
Of lightning and rolling thunder, blessing and honor, strength and glory and power be to you, the only wise King. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. All creation I sing praise to the King of Kings. You are my everything, and I will adore you. Filled with wonder, awestruck wonder at the mention of your name. Jesus, your name is power, breath and living water, such a marvelous mystery. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. With all creation I sing praise to the King of Kings. You are my everything, and I will adore you.
Amen. We're going to have a sermon, and it's going to be done in two parts. The first part is going to be done by George Rodriguez. He's a young man. He's been wanting to do this for a long time. I kept him in the chute and wouldn't let him out. So we're going to see what he can do today. Also, Dr. Neil, Stephan Neil, who is my son, who will be also bringing the second part. And pray for them. They're both kind of nervous today. I don't know if it's the rain or what, but let's keep them in prayer.
Happy Sabbath. Is it on? All right. Well, as she said, I was nervous when she told me to come up here, but I prayed to God, and yesterday I was praying, and he told me I heard his voice say, just go for it. So that's what I'm going to do. Before I start my sermon, I would like to open in a prayer. So can you please all bow your heads? Dear Lord, help me to speak the words that you want me to speak. Work through me and my buddy who's doing the second part over there, Dr. Neil, and help us to get the message that you want us to get and put it out there, and help people when they leave here today know what you're about and your characteristics. In your son's name I pray, amen. All right, well, as you all see in the bulletin, the title of the sermon is The Characteristics of God. Now, I'm going to ask a question. Can anyone answer? Give me one characteristic of God. Anyone? And I'm going to get into that love one as well. Thanks for that answer. But first and foremost, I'm going to get into the first characteristic that I got down here is compassion. God is compassionate to all of us. And I'm going to give you the Bible definition, because God's definition of compassion doesn't change. The definition from the Bible doesn't change. It stays the same. So the definition of compassion is a feeling of pity or sorrow for another suffering. It's a characteristic of God and also should be a characteristic of Christians. So if you say you're a Christian, you should be compassionate towards others. And the first text that I got here is in Romans chapter 9, verse 15 and 16. If you would turn your Bibles to that, please. It's also on the screen there. It says, "For he said to Moses, I will have mercy on whom I will have mercy, and I will have compassion on whom I will have compassion. So then it is not of him that willeth, nor of him that runneth, but of God that showeth mercy." Now, what does this mean? I'll tell you what it means. It means that he's going to show mercy to us, but we have to do our part, because he's not going to only do his part of the thing and not want anything in return. We have to do what he wants us to do as well for him to show us that compassion, that love, and that mercy. I also got one in Deuteronomy chapter 30, verse 3. And as I studied this one, I noticed that it was when they were in captivity. And it says, "That the Lord thy God will turn thy captivity and have compassion upon thee." He's having compassion towards the people that are in captivity. And he's, you know, but the thing is, he's not going to do it on his own. He's going to want us to, as I said before, to show our part in things. He's not going to do everything for us. He gives us everything. He gives us the Bible to read. He gives us the truth. He's not lying to us. It's clear in the Bible that he wants us to do our part as well. And I got 1 Peter 3:8. It says, finally, be ye of all one mind, having compassion one of another, love as brethren, and be pitiful and be courteous. Courteous, it's a part of compassion, you know. Show that you're there to help someone. Give them your hand, because God is giving you his hand, but he wants you to reach out to others and give your hand and pull them in as well and bring them to him. And I've got the next one I got down here for this sermon is one that you all mentioned, is another thing, and these are all connected. They all go together, and it's grace. And as I said before, I took it upon myself to get the Bible definition, not the dictionary definition. It says, the kindness by which God bestows favors and blessings upon the ill-deserving, grants to sinners the pardon of their offense. So, see, if he's telling us here, grace. He has grace, but we gotta, you know, pray and, you know, ask for the forgiveness of our sins. Because he gives grace to the ill-deserving, as it said. He grants the sinner the pardons of their offense. In other words, pray and you will be forgiven. And forgiveness is also a part of grace and a part of compassion. It's all connected. Everything in the Bible that you hear is connected by one thing or another. They all go together. And I'm going to do Ephesians 1:6. If you turn to Ephesians 1:6. If he can get that up on the screen. Thank you. It says, to the praise of the glory of his grace, wherein he hath made us accepted in the beloved. In other words, this verse is what I took out of it. It was talking about Jesus, because Jesus and his grace, he's over there, you know, telling his Father, you know, they're doing good or they're not doing what they're supposed to be doing. And he's talking to us all of us. If you just got to listen for that voice. And when you hear it, he'll tell you what to do. And I got down this Hebrews 4:16. It says, let us therefore come boldly unto the throne of grace, that we may obtain mercy. Through grace, we obtain mercy. And it's shown through the Bible how God shows us that grace, that love, that compassion, that mercy. I mean, look what happened with Jesus. He gave himself up. I don't know how many of you out here would be able to give up your only child. How many, by a show of hands, how many would be able to do that? I know I wouldn't, but he did. I got 2 Peter 3:18. It says, but grow in grace and in the knowledge of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. To him glory both now and forever. And that's the thing. If you come on to Jesus, the grace is not cut. If you stay with him, it's there forever. It's not halfway there. He wants us to meet him halfway to obtain that grace, that mercy that he has in store for us. And I'm going to tell you a little story. A while back, I was talking to Pastor Taylor about wanting to come up here and preach, as she said. And I was, you know, laying in the weeds there, you know, kind of waiting for my opportunity. And with I've been praying for God, and His grace and His mercy and His love for me got me up here and got me to give the first part of this sermon today. He could have picked any day, but He picked today, and it was a surprise to me, by the way. But I got the opportunity, so, you know, I'm up here doing His work and, you know, giving a message to the church, and, you know, I love doing it. I love being up here, you know. I'm the guy that, you know, center of attention type of guy, but other than that, He gave me the opportunity, and that's what I'm up here doing. And as you, back to this, as you all said, a bunch of you said love. Now, question to you, definition, what is love? Does anyone know? Anyone know what love is? I'm pretty sure my mom can answer that. Exactly. Exactly. And I also got the definition, Bible definition again, because you see, the definition in the dictionary of love, it changes. Things, you know, they start giving that worldly definition of love, and, you know, it's thrown around a lot. But I'm going to give the Bible definition. It says the single attribute of God. It's his single, his most attribute. It's the one, it's the thing He gives out the most. And I'm going to give you just three verses from the Bible, three of my favorite verses that I chose out to give you. And the first one is in 1 John 4:8. It says, if can you get that up there? It says, "He that loveth not knoweth not God, for God is love." So in other words, it's saying if you don't love, you don't know God. So it's like He said, you got to meet Him halfway with love. For Him to give you love, you got to show love. And I got 1 John 4:19. It says, "We loved Him because He first loved us." In other words, since He's loved us and He's shown His love for us, we should love Him as much as He loves us. As that girl said in the testimony, she was, you know, loving her family, but she came to know that, you know, you got to love God more than the worldly things, because the world will pass, but God is forever. Amen. And now my last verse that I'm going to get into here is on John 15:12. It says, "This is my commandment, that ye love one another as I have loved you." He wants us to love each other as He loves us. So I'm going to ask you a question. Can we love each other as He loves us? Can we do it? Yes. That's a good answer. I wanted to hear that. And now I'm going to invite Dr. Neil up here to give the second part of the sermon today. And thank God for the opportunity, and you know, I hope to be up here again someday doing more, you know, and I just thank God and Miss Savannah for giving me the opportunity. Amen. Amen. Yeah.
Let's hear another amen for George.
Amen.
Brother, let me tell you something. You did a fantastic job. And I'm right with you. I want to hear you again, because the way that God was speaking to you today, that was clear cut and right to the point where people can understand. My mom said I'm a little nervous today. It's not that I'm nervous. It's been heavy heart this week, especially this morning. This morning I had to go to a funeral for a dear coworker who lost their child just minutes after being born. And it was a genetic thing with the mother where her blood did not clot correctly and she lost the fluids and the baby didn't make it. And so I went to that service this morning and it was just sad to see a life gone in a matter of seconds. And then the people that turned out and people that were crying and to see the infant, I mean, it was, to see the infant, it was like a baby asleep. And then yesterday, with Connecticut, that's right. I mean, I have a son that's 6 years old. And one of the prayers I always pray every morning that the hedges of God would be up there to protect him and his mother every single day. But to imagine those parents who actually woke up and took their kids to school, that they won't see their kids anymore. The Oregon mall shooting. You go there where everyone's celebrating, getting ready for the Christmas season. It's supposed to be about love. And those people are losing family and they're grieving right now. So right now this morning, I have a heavy heart. And it's not about, like, I see that I'm in the bulletin for prayer. Yes, you haven't seen me in a while because of carbon monoxide poisoning. Pretty much had me down. I'm slowly recovering. I messed up my oxygen a little bit. But I can breathe this morning for right now. So that's why you haven't seen me. But thank God that I'm here. But the thing is, one of the other characteristics of God is that he's powerful. And he's powerful to give us strength during these times where we need strength to stand. Do you believe God is able to pick you up and make you stand? Until you know that God is able, you can never cry out for his help. God asked the prophet Isaiah, "How thou not knowest? How thou not heard it? That the everlasting God, the Lord, the creator of the ends of the earth, fainteth not, neither it wearies." God wants us to understand that there is no lack of strength in him. You may not have much of a prayer life, but God say, "How thou not know it." In other words, you should have known that he would take care of you. And the way that you should have known that is when he gave up his son and he came here and he died for our sins. The words say that the everlasting God, the creator of the universe, is all powerful. He has brought you through many problems. Don't let Satan deceive you into thinking that it was just a luck or coincidence that you were delivered. So today, if you have a heavy heart, or if you're going through something, whether it's through a relationship or some type of addiction, know that God is there to strengthen you. All you have to do is pray. It's not luck. It's not a magical pill. But it's spending time with God. And the biggest thing that I had to move through with what happened yesterday in the day is I had to pray and be joyful. Sing to God. Sing up praises. Because in the middle of your trials and tribulations and the suffering that you go through, sing and give a joyful noise unto the Lord. God is my strength and my power. He makes a way out of no way. Remember what God has done for you. If you can't seem to remember anything he has done for you personally, then look around at others who have been delivered out of situations worse than yours. That's one of the things that my mom has always taught me, my dad has always taught me. When you think you've had it worse, look at other people. Even when you got people that say, oh, I wish I was rich. No, you don't. Let me tell you why. Because when you're rich, you got people coming after you. When you are rich, you got people that are willing to sue you over anything. They can go to your car and say, oops, I tripped over your car. Lawsuit. Just being honest. You may say, oh, Dr. Neil is smart. Oh, Dr. Neil is this. Do you realize I got people attacking me every single day on my intelligence? I had someone tell me just the other day, I'm the worst doctor they have ever seen and ever read of reports written. Think about that. I'm on every single board in the state of Arizona, a Magellan board, church, vacation Bible school, Christian sports camp, license in the state of California, 3.67 GPA as a doctorate, but I'm the worst you ever see. But you know what? That's that person's opinion. Because God didn't say so. Right. What God said was, I will put you in places, and all you have to do is acknowledge me and give you the credit. I ain't worried about what no man actually have to say or woman have to say. All I worry about is when God sees me and says, thy good and thy faithful servant, that's all I care about. Long as I'm bringing young people and spreading the word, that's all that matters to me. Not one person's opinion. But God will give you strength to get through to those. Because you know what the first thing I did when I heard that? I prayed for her. That God would open her heart, that she would see something different. Because you know what that told me? She don't like herself. Because you got to remember, a lot of times when people criticize you, because they see something in you that they don't have, so they're going to knock it. But the only way that they get that, or they can change that heart, is by through prayer, and that God would change that person's heart. Some live in rebellions against God's words, which is clearly commands. Trust in the God with all thy heart, and lean not into thy own understanding. In all thy ways acknowledge him, and he should direct your path. Because of their pride, such people never seek God's counsel on anything or consult the advice of the word of God on important decisions. And you know what? That is so true. I listened to some of the interviews that they were doing last night with some of the people at Connecticut, and people are losing hope. You look at our schools today. Why are we having a lot of trouble that we're having in the school? They're taking God out of it. In the midst of whatever situation is, God has to be the center of it, whether it's good or bad. And like my brother George was up there talking about love. People are like, oh, I love you. Well, you believe in God? No. Where there's no God, there's no love. The devil's deceiving so many people that they got these blinders up that they can continue to have the same characteristics without God being involved. I'll give you another perfect example. The AIA is the big sports federation out here in Arizona. Thunderbird Academy is part of the AIA. AIA came up, somebody came out with these character pillars. Good sportsmanship, kind, love, respect, trust, honesty. What are those? Fruit of the Spirit. Young people, read your Bible as George stated. Spend time in God's Word every single day. Start your day out because you never know what you're going to face. Because when you... In order to have that love that George was actually talking about, what he's talking about when he's saying meet halfway, that means have a relationship. That means anytime, like when you have a relationship with someone else, how do you get to love that person? How do you get to know that person? You spend time with them. The more you spend time with them, you start to speak their language. You start to understand what they're thinking before it's actually even said. That's the same way with God. You have to be able to spend that time. Don't make up excuses of, and this goes for everybody, don't make up an excuse of why you can't spend time with God, or I was too busy, or I had to work, or I'm tired. You just don't understand. No. God will give you strength in order to get you through certain situations. There's time my morning starts at 3:30 in the morning and does not end until 11 o'clock at night. And trust me, I'm running on fumes. But you know what? I think about what I read that morning that gets me through. If I feel like I'm about to fall asleep, I hit my phone, pop on Pandora, and got me some Christian music, and I'm up like that. That's what gets you through. That's what will strengthen you. Today we read Psalms 51:10. Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a steadfast spirit within me. That's a prayer that you should pray every single day. Renew a steadfast spirit within you. Because there are no good people. I hear people always saying that all the time. And I heard Doug Batchelor say this, there are no good people. The only person that's good and righteous is God. But what we can do is ask for a renewed steadfast spirit within us that would help us to be a better person, to help us to be a better woman, to help us to be a better man, to be a better husband, to be a better wife, to be a better son, be a better daughter, to be a better boyfriend, be a better girlfriend. But that starts with God. That spirit has to be renewed. But you have to wait on God. God say, if you wait on me, I will renew your strength. If you wait on me, everything will be all right. You may be hurting right now, but be patient. Help is on the way. I know you've cried out, Lord, help me. I've fallen and I can't get up. The Holy Spirit say, wait. Help is on the way. Just hold on. God is coming to your aid. He's coming to deliver you and to set you free. God is going to bring you out and loosen you from your captivity. He's going to renew your strength if you hold on a little while longer. Your change is going to come. One of the things when I close, I want to leave you with parts of this song. And this song has actually helped me these last 3 days. That actually helped me to get through. Because you know what? God is powerful. God is merciful. But the thing is, you have to believe. You have to rely on God for the strength that's going to get you through. Because if you don't rely on him, who are you going to rely on? Like my mama used to tell me all the time, there are going to be times and there's going to be situations where it's just going to be you. And when it's only just you and just your mind, that's where the devil's going to come to deceive you. But your mind has got to be filled with the Lord. So when those things come to hit you up before you fall asleep, that you can remember God is in the midst of you. If you have a little child that's afraid of the dark, and I heard this the other day, the little girl was afraid of the dark. Mommy and daddy, the pastor came up to her and said, you know what? God lives within you. So you know what that little girl is saying? I'm no longer afraid of the dark because God lives within me. So God and I are about to go to sleep and have a peaceful rest. That's the way that you have to be in the midst of your storms. Know that God is within you because God will give you a peace of mind that no one will understand. So the song I want to leave you with is this one. Which I want you to remember, God's mercy is with you day after day. Whatever you may be going through today, hold on, because help is on the way.
Make a reminder for everyone, for Elderman School, to stay in the sanctuary after we leave, okay? The one who has little ones who need to go to the Elderman School to be in the sanctuary, to remain in the sanctuary. We would like to thank you. I hope that we brought you just a little sight of Amen. Christmas holidays in spirit. Amen. We know that Jesus wasn't born on December the 25th, but we all would like to know that sometime in this time year that we recognize God. Isn't that beautiful? That even a sinner have to realize that sometime of the year that there is a God. Please stand. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for this opportunity that we was able to just show a little light of your love. We thank you for George and Dr. Neal who brought us the message. Lord, help us to understand what they was telling us. And help us to be able to go out into the world and bring this forth to everyone. And Lord, I ask you to bless everyone here today. Bless their household. Meet their needs. And Lord, as we leave this church, we ask you to take us in your arms and keep us safe and bring us back again next week. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen.